Enterprise TV, a tradition of truth.
Hello, folks. Welcome to the session Homo Politicus. And this is a program that interrogates contemporary issues thrown up by contemporary Nigeria. And this morning we are looking at opposition politics in the Nigerian country, weighing in on the Atiku formula. Did you get that right? Opposition politics in Nigeria, weighing in on the Atiku formula. Now, it needs to be pointed out that the significance of opposition in nation running is as old as democracy itself. It ensures the responsibility of government and preserves its institutions. That's what opposition politics does. Our collective experience in the fledgling Fourth Republic leaves a very sour taste in the mouth, if you understand what I mean. For a democracy as young as ours, a multi-party system and solid opposition preempts a return to authoritarian rule. Nigeria's opposition politician and candidate of the People's Democratic Party, PDP, in the just concluded 2023 presidential elections, Alhaji Atiku Abubakar, has charged opposition parties to form a coalition against the ruling All Progressives Congress, APC, so it does not turn Nigeria into a dictatorship or a one-party state. But a cursory look at the two frontline opposition parties, namely the PDP and the Labour Party, LP, tells me all is not well. Whereas the PDP appears to be atomistic, constantly divided against itself, the Labour Party is factionalized with Julius Abure and Lamidi Apapa tugging at it from both ends. Alhaji Atiku Abubakar, I should tell you, knows his formula is a hollow ritual. While the opposition is messing around, the ruling APC is enjoying a dry laugh and the country is asphyxiating. So, shall we have a discussion? My discussants this morning are familiar faces. They have lived in Nigeria through these crazy times. So let's meet and greet town planner, biographer, and political commentator, Tochukwu Ezukama. I greet you, Tochukwu.
Jones, I greet you. Good afternoon, and I greet our listeners too.
Oh, you mean viewers?
Viewers.
They are also
they are listening. Yeah, yeah, viewers, listeners.
Yeah, Tochukwu is joined by broadcaster, communications expert, Cyril Abaku. Cyril, I greet you too.
Good morning, citizen. I'm glad to be here. Good morning, Tochukwu.
Gentlemen, morning. Opposition politics in Nigeria, weighing in on the Atiku formula.
Well, the Atiku formula fundamentally is not wrong. In some respect, it's good, it's wonderful. For one thing, there can be no democracy without opposition. When these opposition groups are fragmented or in parts, they may not be as effective as they can be when they unite. It's not the first time there's been an attempt to form a coalition, opposition coalition against a ruling party. I think in the Second Republic, UPN, NPP and
the rest,
GGMPP, they tried to form a coalition against NPN.
Yeah,
it did not work because of variegated interests and different concepts or methods of opposition. And then again, there was a similar attempt at APC itself. It was a unification of opposition parties against PDP,
and it
turned out quite successful. There is nothing wrong with it, and it's something that we should consider seriously. But the question is the motivation of Atiku. Is it doing it for the public good, to enhance Nigerian democracy, strengthen Nigerian democracy, and uplift uplift the masses,
yeah,
improve the situation of the Nigerian masses, hard pressed, long suffering?
Are Nigerians reading him wrongly?
We can't read him wrongly because we've known him for quite some time. His boss, President Obasanjo, never flinched at telling us that Atiku is not a man to be, I'm quoting Obasanjo, Atiku is not a man to be trusted. Atiku is corrupt, that he's stolen so much money from Nigeria, and that Atiku being the president will be comparable to you hearing that an armed robber is now your bank manager. So that undoubtedly shaped the Nigerian concept of Atiku. So we have reasons to read him wrong. But then by his own personal behavior, what we've learned, what we can deduct from his behavior, what Nigerians have seen about him all along, he's been running for presidency for so long.
And Nigerians since 1992.
And Nigerians are beginning to think that this fixation on being the president is a little, is an expression of some kind of selfish ambition. It's like it's me or all or nothing kind of politics. And we also saw a similar thing, some trappings of selfishness or refusal to subordinate personal interests to the public good, to the overall good of the country. We saw something similar playing out in the last presidential election. The Southeast thought that we've been loyal to PDP for so long, we've served PDP for so long.
So therefore, it's time to be rewarded.
It's time to be rewarded, to respect our place as political players, as equal players in the field. But Atiku did refuse to respect that. He ran still for nomination.
We'll come back to the Southeast.
Yes. Yeah, it's all fine, it's all wonderful, but we question the Atiku's motivation in this advocacy for unity of the opposition.
Yeah. Cyril, yes. Tochukwu appears to be talking about the tightrope nature of opposition politics in Nigeria.
Yes.
You agree with him?
I agree with him, but it's not entirely about desires, intentions, declarations, and shall we say opinions or the determination. One of the things that mark out what we call opposition, but what I rather want to advisedly call alternative, would be the fact that a credible opposition usually brings another side to the story. Let's look at the person who is speaking. Who is Vice President Atiku Abubakar? Vice President, 1999 to 2007. He left the PDP and joined the AC to run for president. Am I correct? When he didn't get a ticket against him.
He returned home?
Yes, he went back. He had already became president, but he was in the AC. So he's been in the AC, he came back to the PDP, he left for the ACN, came back to the APC, came back to PDP. You know, he has gone. Even if there are people who have migrated and remigrated from political parties more than he has done, I think he's the poster child of that political, shall I say, instability?
Or lack
of commitment to what we now innocuously call ideology. The question is, what does Mr. Atiku stand for? You couldn't have been...
Or what does he want?
Or what does he really want? So, because every opposition ideally provides, let us say, an alternative in terms of policies, in terms of opinions, in terms of ideology. I think that instead of talking about form an opposition against the APC in 2007, why aren't people talking about providing a formidable, strong, resilient, credible opposition against the APC from now? And not APC in terms of saying fighting the government. We've already seen the failings of the Tinubu presidency from the get-go. The misplaced priorities, the apparent lack of vision, lack of clear direction, policies or somersaults just within months or even within weeks.
You don't think this has to do with an inheritance of some sort?
Anybody claiming inheritance
That's a lame argument?
Very lame argument. The presidency wants to buy a yacht for the wife of the president or for the presidency, whoever. We've not even seen the yacht. The Navy paid for the yacht before the matter even got to National Assembly. Who does that in any sane claim? The president announced that subsidy was gone. Only for us to now say the subsidy is being paid back. Nobody's explained anything to Nigerians, what they did with money that they saved. They floated the naira. The naira is sinking more and more. There's no dollar supply to match up with the rising cost of the forex rate. Who is responsible for that? The president traveled to UAE, and the presidency announced that the travel ban on Nigeria UAE had been lifted. It has not been lifted. Who is responsible for that? Some Nigerians went to Jeddah and were turned back. The federal government said that it was because of crimes that have been committed in the past, offenses that were committed in the past. The Saudi government came and put the light to that statement. Who is responsible? So this president clearly, you can find that he has to hold up his own government. Now, what the Nigerians need is an alternative, not even opposition per se. An alternative that is not primary, because elections are not due until 4 years' time. An alternative that is able to hold them to account.
An alternative in this case, Cyril, if I get you, is an opposition of sorts.
Of sorts.
Running against the...
Yes, which can only be provided by a political...
A united front.
Yes, front that. So if that's what I think is looking at, to be fair, what was the ACN when they were doing that against Obasanjo and Jonathan? They were a tiny lot. Until they did that, until other part, other people like the PDP 7 governors or 5 governors, PDP came, ANPP came, which was CPC.
Even APGA came.
Even APGA came.
Faction of APGA.
So what can Atiku and is the for me, the reality is Atiku does not seem to be a politician who has the impulse or instinct for that kind of opposition politics. I think he considers himself...
You think he's narcissistic?
No. I think he considers himself borderline plutocrat or aristocrat of Nigerian politics. It is not in the mode of a royal to play rebel. But believe me, alternative politics is rebel politics. Tinubu did it, he's president today. What do you want? Is it to maintain your name or your status, which in this case falls within the class of narcissism? Or are you looking for power? And so there's a road to it. Mr. Atiku must convince us that he is a man that is worth the vote or what the support. But since the elections are not done in 4 years, then he must now wake up to primarily let us hear and look. In the 80s, we were talking about UPN and all these parties coming up against the NPN. In the 80s, something needs to happen. Shagari gives his budget today. By tomorrow, the UPN and whatever has produced a counter budget. With figures and tables. Yeah. A counter budget, say, see what you have said, see what you think. Now, Shagari, of course, is right-wing, conservative, okay? Awolo was determinedly Marxist. He played the politics of social welfare, free education. When you talk about progressives, he was clearly progressivist.
Oh, yeah.
But today, if you put Bola Tinubu, who was, I honestly don't know how to put him, but if you put Bola Tinubu here and Atiku here, I honestly don't know what the difference really should be or could be.
You think it's same
difference? There is no, they are just the same. By the way, those two men need to be friends, very, very good friends. Business partners, political associates. I thought by something went all right.
Yeah.
So, but the reality has to be that if you want to serve the, no, it's never about being president. If you want to serve your country, put country first. Provide an alternative. Let's begin from there. All else should then follow later.
Yeah, Chochukwu, in all of this, we are talking the people appears to be the mainstay because they are the target of whatever leadership does.
Yeah,
but do you think the lead in Nigeria is not a part of this morass, of this.
The lead in Nigeria is a part of, I keep blaming it on the leadership, but the leadership has left an imprint on the lead in Nigeria. Because those days, the masses or the lead were a little more.
The bourgeoisie.
The masses and the bourgeoisie were a little more politically sophisticated. They were a little more enlightened, and they expected more from their political leaders. But these days, a certain man was telling me long ago that one thing I liked about President Obasanjo is that he brought us GSM. And if Buhari can fix NEPA, we are all fine with it. It goes about the level of political, lack of political savviness among Nigerians.
Sophistry.
Sophistication among Nigerians. So you're talking, Cyril was talking about political ideology, political philosophy. But if the people you are cooking a dikai call, and fufu for their hunger is
egg rolls.
You're wasting your time. I still remember a case where a governor, a political candidate, a gubernatorial candidate, was telling the chiefs, if you elect me, when you come to visit me, I'll arrange hotels for you. Mm-hmm. To you, that's nonsensical. Is that what the issue is? But to the chief, a comfortable hotel, a hefty brown envelope, and a beautiful woman to keep him company for the night, it's wonderful. So the masses, because their standards dropped over the years, we can blame the leadership for causing the drop in political expectations or political standards, but the standards are very low. So these days, nobody talks about ideology. We talk about trivial issues because that's what the people expect. That's what they want to hear. So anything beyond that will be too much for them.
So my people are not, in the 21st century Nigeria, my people are still not sophisticated?
No, there's not been enough political. The standards of education, standards of enlightenment, the quality of everything in Nigeria dropped. And that's very visible in politics. So
just a minute. So when you hear a thing like this and consider the waves Nigerians are making across the world, that tends to give delight to what you just said.
No, as a matter of fact, I held back from jumping in. Nigerians are not sophisticated. True, but truer is the fact that Nigerians are being prevented from being sophisticated by the power elite, by the kind of things you hear in the news today, by politicians who forgo for substantial issues and discuss trivialities. Okay, the masses are probably not educated. Let's look at colonialism. When they came, we were not expecting them. When they came, we thought we didn't want what they brought. When they came, it was a disruption, it was an interference, it was an interruption. Today, we cannot dissociate ourselves from what they brought. So whether the people appear to be ready for it or not, it is the politician who has who by the grace of his education, by the grace of his vision,
exposure
and enlightenment, should be able to tell people and say, it is time for you to wake up. In the past, it was our poets, the likes of Achebe and Soyinka and Zeke and Co. who said, you people, this what you're seeing today is not right. They fought. Fighting for the masses is not just about going to the outsider to get what belongs to them. It's about telling them that something is their right and that they must arise to that right. Today, bringing back the Tiku Mata and people who have Japa, they know, you see, the environment does not help them to succeed and prosper. So when they go out, you see them doing a lot of great things. Nigerians are winning medals for Jordan, medals for Canada, medals for even Spain, you know.
So, sorry, as an aside, I was watching a match involving Mali and Canada. Mm-hmm. I realized that some Nigerians were playing for Canada.
No, in fact, if you're not careful, in the next 50 years, the next century may not pass before you find a Nigerian becoming Canada prime minister. because the rate of our migration there is a shame.
Crying shame.
It's a crying shame on Nigeria. And I think it appears leadership will not mind saying, if as many of them that can go, let them just go. How does a country lose its doctors, lose its lawyers, lose its engineers, lose its journalists, lose
without caring,
losing an idea? You know, now it brings me to, you see, because we cannot not talk about ideology. This is what sociologists refer to as the liberal class. The liberal class is the holding, is the state of any society, is the gap between the rich and the poor. That's the percolation, basically. It's the conveyor belt. Once the liberal class has been atrophied, forget about that. It does not have a future. So how does a country lose willingly and gladly throw its liberal class in the gutter and hope that, having done that, it will succeed? It will not succeed.
Yeah, but I think it serves the interest of the power elite, because I keep quoting this writer who said that the root of bondage is poverty, and the root of poverty is ignorance. So if you want to hold people in bondage, you have to keep them poor. You have to keep them ignorant. The apartheid system was built on such kind of deceptive, monstrous system. You get the blacks, the majority of them, consumed with the drudgery of daily survival. So you leave Soweto at 6 a.m., get to work at 8 a.m., leave work at 7 p.m. or 8 and get home at 9. You're exhausted. There's nothing else you can do with yourself. So the powers that be want the masses to remain the way they are. And the churches are helping in keeping the masses down.
Religion and churches.
I don't know much about Islam, so I don't want
to use broad churches. Let's use a broad.
Okay, let's say religion. Okay, yeah. Is not helping the matter.
Now you have introduced the religious element. Don't you think the pulpit and the member can come to help you?
The pulpit should come to help. The pulpit, the pastor, has the moral authority of the Word of God. The sacrosanctity of the pulpit. And the inviolability of the church, the body of Christ, or religion.
Yeah.
The pastor can do so much. And if you look at many struggles.
The imam can too.
The imam can, but if you look to many struggles in the past, the pastors were very active. The black American struggle for equality, racial equality, was dominated by men of God. Martin Luther King Jr., Jesse Jackson, Andrew Young, pastors.
And to an extent, Malcolm Little.
Pastors.
Malcolm X. Rosa Parks.
Malcolm X, Louis Farrakhan, Elijah Muhammad. Muslim preachers.
Yeah.
It was dominated by Muslim men because the religious elite are not susceptible to the economic pressures of the powers that be it corporate power, be it government power.
They are insulated.
Your money.
They are insulated.
To a considerable extent. If you're a college professor and you challenge the system, the university will fire you, because even if it's a private university, maybe it gets subventions from corporate bodies or the government. If you're a businessman and you challenge the system, local governments can make things very hard for you. But a pastor can preach and know that his money comes not from the government, and the government has no direct sanction on his source of income, okay? So they have that financial independence. In South Africa, Desmond Tutu, Alan Bosek, they were all very active.
Yes.
But in Nigeria, our men of God got compromised because of the very heavy brown envelopes that come from the powers.
Some got compromised.
Let me not get into that. But then, so that's where.
But you need to go there.
Okay. Why I'm going there, some, and it happens that the some are the very important ones, some that have mass followings. I once talked about a man of God who said that Peter Obi will win the election. And when Peter Obi got rigged out of the election, you were not
when
outraged.
He lost the election.
No, that's my word.
Please, no. But we are teaching. The election has been won and lost.
Okay. When he lost. the election, broadcasting 101, when he lost the election. The man who said he will win, ostensibly inspired by God, a man who prophesized his victory, was not outraged.
Yeah.
He started defending the status quo. Okay, he started using biblical verses
so as not to lose
to support his sophistry. You know, started twisting facts and calling in Bible verses to justify it. And so, so the thing is that
so
the people
essentially, essentially, my people are in a vice; they are trapped.
The masses are trapped in it. But then the masses, let me just make this point. The masses, irrespective of their number, irrespective of their strength, irrespective of their righteous anger, cannot get anything done unless they are led, unless they are directed strategically. Mm-hmm. Mandela led the masses, but he wasn't a member of the masses, he was a lawyer. Martin Luther King Jr. led the masses, but he was PhD theology. Mm-hmm. Nigerians need those leaders that can lead the masses. You don't have to be one of
them. Because they are there.
They are there. Many are compromised, many are timid, many for one reason or the other have refused to come out, but they are there. But expecting the masses to do anything on their own, they cannot.
Okay, then, the viewer must understand this is Homo Politicus on Enterprise TV in Lagos, and we're looking at opposition politics in Nigeria, weighing in on the Atiku formula. By the way, Atiku, for those who don't already know, is a former vice president of Nigeria. He gave a press conference on Tuesday and suggested that opposition parties must team up to prevent Nigeria from sliding into an authoritarian leadership. And that's what we are interrogating. Cyril, are we trapped? Can we ever come out of this alive?
Sure, we can. Except that I do agree with former Vice President Atiku. I think we're back out to a very large extent. When we say authoritarian. Well, if you look at the political antecedent of the current president, he is somebody who, as I've described him at the previous point, who likes to jaw rather than war. He prefers to make friends. Why make an enemy when you can make friends? So he prefers to make friends, he prefers to dialogue, he prefers to settle than to have you form an opposition. So to that extent, what we may see would be a case in which the president's word will be the last on several issues. Not because he is coercing men, but because I think there's a way he does it. That people nationally just want to coalesce around him, agree with him, work with him, no matter what the cost is. So this is my own concern. If that were to happen and you have up to 8% of the political class supporting him, I don't see what else you want to call it, if not to say is one man rule or something like that. Because the fact of the matter is that this president is such a man who can make as many friends as possible without necessarily feeling any differently. He's a man that can reach out, meet people, have conversations with them, strategize, hold meetings again. So he's the president and his way. Maybe Atiku is worried that if the president throws his charm at people at certain important people and they go to work for him, he will be stranded. He will be left alone on the island. So that's, I think, really Atiku's fear. But beyond Atiku's fear, because of course, Toshiku said it correctly, without opposition, or without what I call an alternative, believe me, what is going to happen will not be anything more than the fact that now all the other parties are sort of dead, whether knowingly or unknowingly. Mm-hmm. There is only one party standing. Look at Lagos. Where is the PDP in Lagos? Where is the Labour Party in Lagos? Mm-hmm. I mean, one man, and it was just the case of one man that knows how to reach out to people and to get them to and to get them to you know, play ball with him. So what do we do? What do we do? How what can be done? I don't think that the call should be left Atiku alone. Forming an opposition does not mean that you hate Tinubu. It means that you love democracy. So what can we do? What can be done that can produce credible...
Otherwise, forming an opposition goes beyond seizing power from the
government. Exactly. In fact, there is a way you put pressure on the government in power and you begin to do your bidding. And that will succeed.
Yeah.
I would always to say, even if I'm not in government, you've seen what I've written. Implement it. Free education for Nigerian students for the next 10 years. If you're interested, this is the document, go and implement it. You know? So, what about an opposition group does? It does things that help government make better decisions, whether they are part of it or not.
Yeah.
So, and this can Atiku and his people be that altruistic, be that impersonal about it?
Mm.
With be patriotic to put Nigeria first. If they fail to achieve this and they will want to go into government and change things, that in itself will be a failure.
Tochukwu, you get the impression after listening to him that our politicians in Nigeria who have become, if you ask me, Machiavellian, you know, by all and every means possible, it looks like we are doomed. You get it. We have got to our wit's end.
The situation is really bad, terribly bad, but I don't think we are doomed. I don't think the situation is hopeless. A lot can still be done. In the past, I so much believed in Nigerian democracy, but I'm beginning to have a lot of doubts about Nigeria and democracy. I don't think we are prepared enough. Sentimentally, emotionally, politically, attitudinally, to be a democracy as we got our independence in 1960. But then, even with the low standards we had in like instance, with the rustic skills of our political leaders in 1960, things got conspicuously worse over the years. I am an optimist, and I thought that Nigerian democracy, given time, will change. But the way things are happening, especially with the elections, I'm beginning to think that democracy on the short run may not be what we need. There are some countries of the world that are not democracy. China is not a democracy, but China has done exceptionally well, especially since after the death of Mao Zedong, and power changed hands into Deng Xiaoping and then his successors. So we need to go back to the drawing board and get a few things right. The things we need to get right before we get back to this attempt at democracy must be respect for the rule of law. Nigerians are so lawless. Nobody has any respect for the law. Nobody enforces the law. I heard that a Nigerian journalist once asked Bill Clinton, "What advice do you have for Nigeria?" Bill Clinton said, "Enforce your laws. We have wonderful laws in our law books, but they don't get respected. They don't get enforced. So if we learn to enforce our laws, if we learn to respect our fellow human beings, play by the rules, have some moral and ethical standards, and learn to subordinate our personal interests to the public good, to the collective good of the country, that will help us a lot." So my answer to your question is, the things are terribly bad, but we are not totally doomed. Our situation is not completely hopeless or intractable.
Yeah. Cyril,
yes.
I'm just going through some of the quotes,
yes,
credited to the late Napoleon Bonaparte. He said, "Imagination governs the world." And Albert Einstein said, "Imagination is everything."
Of course it is. It is. And so the question is, what is the Nigerian imagination? What captures our minds? What's the common denominator when it comes to Nigerian thought, if there's anything like that, Tochukwu? Again, what's in Atiku's imagination, what does he hope to achieve with the move for an opposition? I mean, it's laudable, but it's not everything. We must know the details of what exactly this wants to achieve. Could that be the solution we've been waiting and waiting for and expecting? Or are we to wait for another to come? The fact is, Mr. Atiku has, as former vice president and being who he is and everything is, obviously has the war chest, has the capacity, has the connections, has the armada of resources to be able to command such an army. But is he just ready for that? Is he ready to play this other way? We remember in under Buhari's second term, people kept on saying, "Where is Atiku? Where is Atiku?" It was not to be found. Only went to show up and say he was going to run for president. So, but where there is real willingness, where there is keen interest in moving this country forward, where there is sufficient will and zeal to pull this through, and that's why it should fail. There's a whole lot to be dealt with. When you talk about imagination, there's a whole lot to be dealt with. Nigerians don't, I don't think today that there are very many Nigerians who believe that this country will get better by through politics. I'm not sure that if there are those who
through democracy.
Through democracy and through electoral politics, I don't think so. So if
politics... So you don't belong to this school that insists there is a so-called Nigerian type democracy?
Well, even if there were,
what does it really mean?
And what has it done for Nigeria? Yes, nothing. So that's a problem on its own. And how do we deal with it? We must go back to the thinking, to the drawing board. You see, there are political philosophers, there are people who do all kinds of things. How is it that for a country as blessed with human resources as Nigeria is, University of Ibadan, University of Lagos, Nsukka, Nigeria, Nsukka, ABU, OAU, Ile-Ife. I am not sure the last time a Nigerian university contributed to solving the national problem in this country. I can't remember the last time that you say this or this university brought the solution to this problem. I've not seen it before. Not in 10 years.
Yet every year, every year Nigerian universities graduate first class students. Abi,
it's a problem. It's a real problem. So this is so. Who then thinks about Nigeria? Who is thinking these thoughts?
Okay. Gentlemen, we must wrap the whole show up here. At this point, I want to thank Tochukwu Ezukama for coming.
You're welcome.
No less so, Cyril Abaku.
My pleasure.
Many thanks. So, that's our program for today. Until the next time, stay well and stay positive. I am Citizen Jones Osei. Bye-bye now.
Enterprise TV, your one-stop shop for news, programs, human angle stories, the economy, sports, and much more. We go the extra mile to bring incredible details to you. So hop on the train now. Enterprise TV,